Thank you so much, sir, for that generous introduction. It is indeed a pleasure to stand before you, most of the luminaries of the Rotary Wing fraternity and the aerospace fraternity, and our friends from the friendly foreign countries. I welcome you all to this session, and just like to make a mention that this session is special to me for more than one reason. This is indeed the first time that I am speaking to a forum like this, the Aero India seminar. Secondly, this is also a unique opportunity for me because my wife is in the audience and I get to do all the talking and she gets to do all the listening. Having said that, sessions after lunch are usually very, very tough on the audience, not so much on the speaker. So I'll try to keep this talk as interesting, as short, as focused as possible. I've also ensured a generous supply of videos to keep you all awake. And at the end of it, I look forward to interaction, questions. I represent the men in white. We are a small community here in Bangalore, and it is our job to talk to you, to educate you on the intricacies of ship helicopter deck flying, and that's what I intend to do in the next 20 to 25 minutes. First, I'll just recount a small situation which we often find out at sea. It's a couple of hours after sunset. The sun has set into the Indian Ocean. As a pilot in the cockpit of a naval multi-role helicopter, I have been witness to the last vestige of light disappearing, taking with it all vestige of the horizon. I am on my approach to a ship. The destination is reporting a 30 knot crosswind and partly cloudy skies on a clear moonless night. There is no VOR ILS to help you, no aerodrome beacon, no autonomous approach and landing aids. Fuel is down to minimum. There is no diversion, nowhere else to land. And if that's not enough, the landing pad is slightly smaller than a badminton court and it's moving in 6 degrees of freedom. It's a task that has challenged the best helicopter pilots since the middle of the last century and continues to do so. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to represent the unsung heroes that operate from naval ships in challenging conditions to execute highly complex missions over sea. My presentation will focus on the design and integration challenges of shipborne helicopters, and I'll endeavor to cover the topic under the heads as shown. We'll have a brief look at the roles and challenges that are before us, introduction to the shipboard environment, of which I'm sure all of you are well advised. I'll just try to point out the finer nuances. Afloat integration challenges. We had a very brilliant talk by Professor Venkatesan in the morning session in which he described his efforts at developing a mini helicopter, autonomous helicopter. I would like to put the pilot's perspective into it because we are not yet lucky enough to have autonomous helicopters. We have to do all the flying ourselves. So I'll try and give you the pilot's perspective on it, and then we'll conclude with what is likely to be the future. Naval helicopters, as you all are aware, are the vital punch of the naval fleet. They are the eyes and ears of the naval fleet. They are the long arm of the naval fleet. The traditional roles that we undertake are those of search and rescue, logistics, casualty evacuation, and communication link. But because of the inherent flexibility of the helicopter and its capability to quickly adapt to different situations, we have also loaded combat roles such as anti-submarine warfare, anti-surface vessel warfare, electronic warfare, and of late, in the last 7 to 8 years, heli-borne early warning. But there is a new spectrum of operation that is facing us now. We have seen over the last decade that the nature of war itself is changing. The security landscape has changed post 9/11. Trouble can erupt at any point of time, anywhere in the world. There are a whole host of asymmetric threats There is an ongoing fight for scarce resources. How does it affect us? The dimensions have shrunk and have increased, and the time has shrunk. What means essentially is that naval ships today are expected to deploy at a moment's notice to any far-flung corner and be tasked with missions that are still evolving. And helicopter, because of its inherent flexibility, becomes a prime candidate, becomes the vital punch in such missions. So the new spectrum of ops that we see over and above what I listed earlier are ops in the littoral. Littoral is basically the area close to the seashore where most of the human population is settled. Overland surveillance, tactical lift, humanitarian ops, counter-piracy. Counter-piracy, incidentally, has become a most often, most frequent tasking for naval helicopters because of the ongoing piracy issues in the Gulf Coast. I don't have to introduce this gathering to shipboard operations, but I would just like to point out that they are indeed the most challenging of any piloting task for fixed or rotating aircraft. In addition to all the other vagaries of the helicopter, we have low visibility and poor visual cues. We have deck motion, ship motion to contend with. Turbulence, because operating the lee of the ship. A restricted landing area. And a whole lot of environmental and human factors, which compound the job of the air crew as well as the supporting crew. And this happens, ladies and gentlemen, by day and by night, 365 days in a year, 24/7. So you really don't have a choice in the matter. You do not pick the missions, you do not pick the time of the day, and you can expect to be launched at any time, at short notice, for a wide spectrum of roles. Okay, here comes the first video. Now, typically, this is how a very good day in office can turn totally disastrous. We have seen a video of ground resonance in the presentation in the forenoon session of the autonomous vehicle. Here we have a 13-ton helicopter breaking into pieces because of the medium and the stresses and the loads and the additional the loads that are subjected to the shipborne helicopter. And this probably is a classic case of the kind of hazardous situations that we are likely to face when operating from helicopters. So he's just making another routine landing on the deck. He's well positioned, he's just about touching down. He's touched down with a small drift to the starboard. And he's getting into resonance. And within a matter of seconds, you have lost 13 tons multi-million dollar vehicle. Now this is, I would not call it a negligence or an error on the part of the pilot. Of course, there is an element of piloting involved in this, but this is an environment that we operate in. You've seen the amount of space that is available. The winds are not of his choice. The conditions are not of his choice. He must be probably returning after a long mission, tired to the bone. We have a wide array of ships, a wide array of helicopters. At last count, we have over 15 classes of ships, 15 plus classes of ships, and almost 7 types of helicopters. So you can imagine that potentially there is almost a 75 to 90 combinations possible. Each platform has its own limitations. The platform, by platform I mean both the helicopter as well as the afloat platform. There are a wide spectrum of roles. Helicopters have to operate from one ship on one day, another ship from the other day. They have to interoperate with a whole host of limitations. There is very little support available on call. So these are the challenges of interoperability that we routinely face. Then there are challenges of fitting into the ships. Ships and helicopters are not manufactured concurrently, not manufactured by the same agency. There is an intricate process of adapting them to each other. But sooner or later, the project, whichever is leading, that takes priority and the other guy has to catch up. So there have been situations where we have been called upon to integrate a new type of helicopter onto an existing type of ship, or vice versa. There are challenges of hangar fit, there are challenges of deck fit. Here's a naval test pilot on job, and he's measuring the clearances that are likely to be available on this platform, on this afloat platform, and trying to factor out what will be the impact of ship motion, deck motion, and the vagaries of weather. So these are the challenges. Finally, at the end of the day, nobody wants complaints, nobody wants no for an answer. So finally, we all aim for seamless interoperability. That means that we try to impose minimum limitations on the ship. We try to impose minimum limitations on the helicopter so that the work goes on. And it is this effort which is an ongoing process of refinement. And today, we have achieved to a large extent a seamless interoperability. As long as the flight deck is capable of taking a certain class of helicopter, we have done the trials, we have done the integration, and we have evolved some kind of envelope within which it can operate. Ship is home to several disciplines. No single department owns the ship. It is shared by a whole host of departments. Everybody has got contrasting requirements. There are space constraints all the while. And let me remind you that the flight deck is often looked at by the ship as a very large piece of real estate available to the aviators, which can be used for purposes other than flying, such as hosting parties. So we have contrasting requirements. We have a low freeboard. Low freeboard, I mean, the flight deck is almost the closest point to the water. So we take all the beating of the weather, of the sea state, of the sea spray. And in the tussle for prime ship locations, usually we get left behind, so to say. So we have to make do with this. We have to adjust. We cannot demand more than what is already available. And we have to fit into the ship, the final objective being that we are part of the Naval Air Arm. We are not Indian Naval Air Force. We are part of the Naval Air Arm, which means we have to seamlessly integrate with the ship and make sure that the ship as a whole performs as a weapon system. We had a presentation again in which we showed the 6 degrees of freedom of the autonomous helicopter. Now we have a combination of a helicopter and a ship, both of which move in 6 degrees of freedom. So for those of you from the scientific community, I would invite you to take a whale of an opportunity to sail on the ships and see the full 6 degrees of motion in action. And if you are fortunate to see helicopter operations, you will see how the pilot, not being aware of all the variables that he is faced against, is still trying to compensate and achieve the mission of landing and takeoff. And this is just an event. Landing and takeoff is just an event. The real job starts after that, after takeoff, the mission. However, during the approach and landing, the aircraft has to contend with the platform which is moving 6 degrees. And each ship has got its own dynamics. Because of its design, its center of gravity, center of buoyancy, metacentric height, a combination of the ship characteristics and the ocean characteristics. Even the ocean characteristics are not under anybody's control. You could have a day on which the wave period, that is the time period between successive peaks, is say 6 seconds. On another day, you would have a period of 4 seconds. You could have wave heights changing anything from glassy flat calm seas to wave heights of 10 meters. So a combination of the ship design and the oceanic characteristics define the dynamic behavior of the ship. What we don't see when we land, and I am very happy that we don't see this when we land, is the air wake that imposes on the helicopter, which is what makes this evolution totally different from the flying which goes on ashore. Shore operations or approach, recovery, takeoffs from ashore normally, in most cases, happen under benign conditions, under streamlined conditions, except when you have some amount of turbulence, which is seldom. On a landing on a ship, you are routinely facing turbulence in the lee of the hangar, and in some cases it can be as bad as to throw you completely off balance and you may have to abort and make another approach. So I'm quite happy that we are not able to see it. Maybe the designers are able to see it. They're able to find fixes for this. But when you make an approach, when you are operating the lee of the hangar, you are totally oblivious to this. You're just reacting to what is being thrown at you. Okay, just watch this video. This is one of the flight tests going on of a modern helicopter. And watch that as he is about to, the ship has probably rolled too much for his comfort. And I'll play that again for you. You watch this area over here. The clearances between the rotor and the ship deck has been of the order of inches. So he's just been purely lucky that he survived this, and it could have led to another disastrous occurrence. We watch the closure in this area where he, when he takes off, his rotors have come within inches of the ship deck. So these are the vagaries, these are the, and this was actually a flight test which was happening, because of which we got this video clipping. And this is not, it's just a representative video, it has not been done by the Indian Navy. Just to show how an accentuated ship and helicopter motion together can lead to a very dangerously close situation. Okay, these are the types of trials that we undertake in the Navy. There are five of us right now in the Navy, five test pilots and a couple of test engineers who are undertaking these trials. And these trials are, they vary in spectrum from the first of class, which is a combination of a new ship and a new helicopter, or a new ship and an existing helicopter, or an existing ship and a new helicopter. First of class. First of class trials are done quite exhaustively. Obviously, that is a new combination. It's a new activity. So it is done in detail. Then we have requirements coming up where the operational authorities feel that the envelope or the helicopter operating limits from the ship are far too less and they want to expand it. So we try to expand it. We do envelope expansion trials. We are also continuously modifying our procedures to see how we can operate better. So there could be trials for new procedures, new landing spot, new approach type. Conventionally, we in the Navy, we make approaches from the stern. But there could be occasions where you would like to make an oblique approach. You may like to make a cross-deck approach. So new procedure, new landing spots, shawl. By shawl, I mean ship helicopter operating limits. Shawl revalidation. These are called for after the environment in the vicinity of the ship or in the vicinity of the flight deck is modified. These days, there are a whole host of antennae. SATCOM antennae, Charlie band, KU band, antennas being fitted, and the obviously, the like I mentioned, that the big piece of real estate which is vacant at the back, and the immediate vicinity of that becomes a prime location for these fits. So the moment we have anything fitted in the vicinity of the hangar or in the vicinity of the flight deck, it calls for another round of trials to revalidate that the envelope which has been earlier promulgated still stands valid. And then of course the most benign of that is the trial landing on follow-on ships. So if each class of ship has got say 6 or 7 ships, after we do the first of class trials, thereafter we do follow-on trial landings just to ensure that the corner points of the previous first of class ship is valid for the follow-on ships. So this potential combination of almost 90 possibilities of ship and helicopter combinations is what keeps us busy. Now this is just to show you that the typical land-based limits and the ship-based limits of a helicopter could be different, and indeed they are different for obvious reasons, because the testing of the helicopter is done ashore, certain envelope is evolved. Now when you go on to the ship air wake modifies the handling qualities, modifies the characteristics of the helicopter on board, and this is typically a plot of the outer circle, the semicircle which you see. This is the land-based limit, and those little shapes which are drawn there depict the areas where the pilot or the test pilot who has done the trials has found that this part is unsuitable for operation, unsuitable for exploitation because of issues such as turbulence, pedal margins, torque margins, field of view, etc. Now why does this happen? Why should you need additional testing? Why can't we finish this business ashore and get on with it? So the answer is quite simply that what I said, the helicopters are tested ashore, they are taken to ships. They are taken to ships indeed. Ship trials are done, but that is just for specific issues. The shawl development or the envelope development becomes a user's activity. It is not a OEM's activity. So this is just to show that people who come to flight test out at sea usually find it, you know, quite inconvenient to stay on board ships for obvious reasons. So they would like to go back to Bangalore. And flight manual limits obviously not fully valid for shipborne operations. There is requirement to tone down the weight capability of the helicopter. There is requirement to tone down the low speed envelope of the helicopter at times. Now these additional limitations, they are caused because of certain reasons. The air wake turbulence, which I mentioned earlier. So typically if you see, if you had nothing in front of the flight deck, if the flight deck was a runway, I don't need to have a separate envelope. But the moment you start putting blunt surfaces ahead of the flight deck, it modifies the airflow pattern, it modifies the handling characteristics of the helicopter in that environment. There is random, unpredictable eddies, unpredictable non-laminar flow. There is ship motion to contend with. There is a restricted area. There is issues of obstructions. You have to ensure that all parts of the helicopter are adequately protected under all conditions of ship motion. Visual cues. You have to ensure that adequate visual cues are available for the pilot to undertake the mission of the evolution of landing and takeoff. And of course, sea spray, exhaust gas nuisance. Now, exhaust gas nuisance is a big problem, especially on gas turbine ships, ships which are propelled by gas turbine engines, because those exhaust temperatures are typically much higher than diesel exhaust. And we have found on certain ships that we had to impose an additional weight penalty on the helicopter because of the variation in the flight deck ambient environment temperature. In some cases, you would find that the temperature on the flight deck is almost 4 to 5 degrees more than the clear air temperature. So that is almost like flying in a, you know, in a different density altitude altogether. And this is not streamlined, this is random. So you will have power fluctuations, you will have occasions of running out of power. So there have been cases, especially on large ships such as tankers, where we have imposed additional weight penalties on the aircraft, on the operating of the helicopter. So what are these variables that we have to contend with when we mate a helicopter with a ship? These are some of the variables. Variables imposed because of the ambient conditions, variables because of the aircraft, and variables because of the ship. Now you can see that these are not independent. They are independent to a large extent, but they are also interconnected, which means that if you change the weight and CG of the helicopter, the conditions of operating that helicopter on the deck may not necessarily be the same. The envelope which is finally evolved has to stand the test of all possibilities, of all combinations of these variables, which means that a newly qualified pilot who's just got his deck landing qualification should be able to land that helicopter on a day when the visibility is marginal, on a day when the sea state is not good, on a day when the deck is rolling and pitching, as well as a very experienced pilot. So all possible combinations have to be met. So that is what defines the flying effort. So for a simplistic helicopter such as the Aleut, the flying effort would be of the order of 6 to 10 hours. However, for an aircraft like the ALH or say the Sea King or the MRH, it could go anywhere between 40 to 50 hours of test flying to evolve the envelope, to make sure that the pilot with average flying skill who is flying off these decks has adequate amount of safety within the entire spectrum of all these variables, within the entire envelope of the aircraft, within the entire type, mark, series of the aircraft, the center of gravity positions, pilot station, density, altitude, day, night. Day and night, of course, are two different envelopes. For obvious reasons, the night envelope is a subset of the day envelope. But these are the independent variables which we have to test and clear. Now, there are issues. There are issues with the helicopter. There are issues with the ship. These issues are interconnected. These issues are what I call build issues. How the helicopter is built, how the ship is built. These impose, finally, in the long run, when you promulgate the envelope, when we promulgate the ship helicopter operating envelope, the build issues of the helicopter and the ship both together determine the operating envelope. Now, there is nothing wrong with the helicopter. I mean, in the sense that each helicopter is manufactured or designed against a whole lot of, you know, varying requirements. There are varying requirements of a helicopter. It has to be factored in. And having interacted with the designers, I realized that there is so much you can do. There are so many things that one has to factor: stability, agility, hover performance, rotor area, rotor disc area. On ships, you cannot have rotors which are too big, whereas for good hover performance, you need a large rotor. Blade folding, rotor type, ALH example, we have a rigid rotor system and we have incorporated a blade folding system on that. Gross weight versus payload. Typically, the carrying capacity of helicopters from ships normally are lesser than shore. Sensors, ground clearance. Sensors, big issue, because there are sensors which have to be put under the helicopter. There are sensors which have to be put on the sides of the helicopter. The sensors which go under the helicopter impinge on the bottom clearance of the helicopter from the deck. Sensors which go on the sides impinge on the finally folded dimensions. So there have been cases where we have moved aircraft, helicopters into hangars with just few inches to spare. So this combination has to work under the tough conditions out at sea, under
high sea states. So there is a need to look at all this. What I am trying to say is that you cannot pick any helicopter and try to operate it from the deck. It has to be designed keeping the ships in mind, keeping the environment in mind, keeping the limitations that we have on the ships in mind. Shipboard compatibility being a overriding factor. Traversing system. Now, once you put the helicopter down on the deck, your job is not done. You still have to take it inside the hangar. You still have to have a capable system which can take multiple type of helicopters inside the hangar. Imagine moving a 12-ton helicopter on the ship. It can never be done manually. It has to have a foolproof system which will work under different conditions of sea. This is another area where we are finding a lot of problems, because we are now having 6-7 different types of helicopters. We do not have traversing system which are capable of handling all these helicopters. Typically, we would like to have a system which handles all of them. Otherwise, a particular helicopter may be moved inside, another helicopter may not be able to move inside. If you cannot move it inside, you straight away have a limitation that helicopter cannot operate on that ship for sustained operations. Helicopter specific dependencies. Now, these are issues with the helicopter which can impinge on the shawl, that is the stability and handling characteristics. By what I mean is the characteristics at low speed, because at high speed you are not making any contact with the ship, you are handling it at low speeds. So what are the characteristics, handling characteristics of the helicopter at low speeds? You can understand, there are people here who are designers, they will understand. I understand that at low speeds everything works against you. At low speed everything in the helicopter works against you. It is tougher to fly slow than fast, because the stabilizing surfaces are not that effective. Some of the stabilizing surfaces turn destabilizing. So you are operating the helicopter always in the low speed envelope from a ship. So the type of envelope that the basic helicopter has, that itself will determine the final capability of the helicopter on a ship. Recovery assist system fitted on the helicopter. We have been typically using the harpoon deck lock, which is a probe which comes out under the belly of the helicopter and locks itself onto a grid on the ship. This is not a complete solution. This only assists you in touchdown. However, the evolution of coming down from hover down to landing, down to hitting the, or down to sitting on the deck, is still done manually. The undercarriage has to be specifically designed for ship deck operations. It takes a lot of beating, it takes a lot of tough landings on the ship, because each landing on a ship is a firm landing. There are no copybook, no kissers, landings done on the ship. Each landing is a very firm sit down. So the undercarriage has to be capable of taking that beating around the year, and you can impose the conditions, corrosive environment that under which it flies. The tail section, some of you may have seen our Alouette or Chetak helicopter, which has got a flat tail. Now, flat tail straight away means that his tail rotor is going to be much closer to the ship deck as compared to a helicopter like the Sea King or the ALH, on which the tail rotor is mounted on an elevated platform. Slope landing capability. Finally, we are doing variable slope landings all the time on a ship. Every landing is done under different varying slope, and you may find that during the process of landing itself, the slope has changed from starboard to port or from left to right. So the slope landing capability, or the ability of the helicopter to operate from the ship, is finally going to be a subset of the slope landing capability to which the ship is aircraft is cleared. Now this is how the envelope finally looks. When we finish the trials, you will have certain radials of wind speed, and you will have certain wind speed and direction combination which is cleared. And by WOD, it's a wind over deck, which is a relative wind over deck, which is a combination of the ship's speed and the ambient wind. And of course, the night envelope will be a small portion of the day envelope. The characteristics of the ship and the characteristics of the helicopter and the flight testing effort which has been put in, all three of them finally determine this envelope. Okay, this is another test point that we did recently, about 2 weeks back, in which we were carrying out certain trials of the Alouette from a ship. And it was a difficult point in the sense we were heavily loaded. We were validating the envelope which is already tested. So we were doing the maximum all-of-it validation. Now this was a difficult deck. It was a very small deck. It was a very turbulent deck. It was not at all a good day out at sea. The sea motion was, ship motion was rising to peaks. And we faced a situation which completely escaped us when we did the low weight test. In the low weight test, we did not encounter this problem because of some strange reason, because of probably the difference from one test point to the other, because every day, every landing is different. So we missed out this, we did not encounter this problem at low weight. So when we tried it at high weight, a combination of turbulence and a high exhaust temperature from the ship literally forced us down on the deck. And we were not prepared to land. We were still testing out something just aft of the landing spot. And you can see that we were finding it difficult to match with the ship. The ship was pitching quite a bit. And a couple of efforts were aborted. And finally, at one point, the ship and the helicopter both rose towards each other and we ran out of power. And it was a complete arrival. So this is an unplanned landing. This landing was unplanned. It was not meant to be a landing, but literally the combination of high temperature and ship motion forced it onto the deck. And you may recall the photograph in which we were measuring the difference between the tail and the ship. In this case, the clearance between the tail guard and the ship was again of the order of a few inches. And it was very unpleasant. Obviously, such points will not be cleared for exploitation. Such points cannot be cleared for exploitation. And remember, this should be hackable. This should be possible to do it even at night. These are two test pilots inside. It should be possible to land off an approach like this even for the most inexperienced, deck qualified pilot. So these are the kind of points that we would not like to clear for fleet operations. And this reflects the vagaries. This reflect the kind of variables that you have to face over which you have no control, but to exclude them from the cleared envelope. Now, some of the ship-specific dependencies, the layout of the flight deck. Typically, the flight deck in the Indian Navy is right aft. I mean, in all ships worldwide. Some ships have got flight decks ahead of the superstructure. There are very few of those ships, such as some of the survey vessels, some of the landing crafts. They got decks ahead of the superstructure. Basically, the design of the superstructure. If you have a flight deck ahead of the superstructure, there are issues about making the approach. Because now you have to make an approach from the side and then slide onto the deck. You're always more comfortable making an approach onto something which you can clearly see. So one would obviously prefer a helicopter deck at the back. But remember, if you had a helicopter deck in the center of the ship, I would be the most happy, because that is the place where the ship motion would be the least. But these locations, or what I call the prime ship locations, are already gone. They're already taken by the weapon systems. They're already taken by the crew stations, where the bunks are there, the living stations, because they have to be finely comfortable. You cannot put human beings right aft and subject them to pitch motion. So the prime spaces are already gone. So we get the plot of land right aft, which is disadvantageous in some ways. But at the end of the day, if one has to make an approach, one would obviously like to make an approach to something which one can clearly see. So conventionally, the helicopter decks are right aft. Ship stabilizers. There are ships which have stabilizers which can control ship motion to a large extent. Now what happens in these cases, you can expand the capability of the ship to operate helicopters. Disposition of the ship's exhaust, which I already mentioned, which has got undesirable effects on the operation. Maximum speeds. The combination of the ship speed and the wind speed determines the envelope. So if a ship cannot do more than, say, 8 knots, then there is only so much it can do. If the winds are only 5 knots, it cannot launch in the wind envelope which is more than 8 plus 5. Ship's dynamics, we already covered. We've seen an example of that in the previous video. Okay, just another video before we round off. This is a situation where the ship has altered course when the helicopter is not ready for it. Again, a situation which is totally avoidable, and we lost a helicopter. This is again a representative video. So, very good day in office. The ship has altered course. The helicopter is not ready. And for lack of mooring points, we have lost a complete helicopter. And thankfully, in all these videos, nobody was hurt or injured. And it is just a good fortune that they are just hanging by a fine line over there. Okay, AIDS. Ship helicopter testing costs are prohibitive. Operating a ship out at sea can be anything. I mean, they cannot put a price to it, but it could be anything upwards of 50 lakhs per day, plus the helicopter operating costs. So these testing costs are prohibitive. So we have to use wind tunnel testing. We have to use computational fluid dynamics to assess the situation before we actually, to minimize the flying effort, minimize the testing effort. And we have seen that if you make little changes to the environment in the around the flight deck, there are large benefits, disproportionate benefits. But it is possible only if you have the scientific tools and we are still, the world is still moving towards that. At the end of the day, these are only 8 flight testing still required. It is still required, and I'm saying thankfully, because that's what keeps people like me in the business. In the future, I would like to see better aids for ship deck flying. This is a largely neglected area in the domain of ship helicopter operations. It's pretty much like seminar auditorium hall A, B and C. So, you know, by the time you reach the flight deck, the shipbuilder runs out of resources or money. And we still need to have smarter flight decks. We still need to have aids. We still need to minimize. We need to automate. We need to minimize the human effort involved. Need accurate sensors to give you ship motion, to give you predictive aids, predictive ship motion systems, which will cue the pilot when to land. It is in existence, but they are still not completely, I would say, as evolved as the rest of the shore-based aviation is. Use of night vision goggles can make your life pretty easier. Again, we are still in a stage where we are evolving. We are still not completely night vision aided in the Indian Navy, but we are getting there. Thank you. That's all I have, and I'm ready to take your questions if the chair permits.
Yes. Questions for 5 minutes. Anybody with questions?
Actually, it's not the maximum. It's not the maximum ship speed. Actually, it's a combination of ship speed and the ambient winds. Upper limit is reached through testing, but normally it is not more than 30 to 35 knots. In some ships where there is very little superstructure ahead of the flight deck, we have gone up to 45 knots. That is a combination of ship speed and the wind speed. So if the ship is doing 20 knots and a 25 knots ambient wind, you're heading into it, you can land up to 45 knots. Not all ships. Because as you increase the forward motion into the sea, the pitching motion of the ship increases. So it imposes limits.
With respect to ALH, due to saline atmosphere, general specific problems you are facing?
Well, we have thankfully not had specific problems of ALH with respect to shipboard corrosion, because we have not subjected that to very long drawn operations. We have operated only for 2 or 3 days, and sometimes we operate for a month, but that is on the carrier. Now, on the carrier, you are way above the sea level, way above the water level. So, the problem of corrosion is that much more. We have got no reason to suspend ALH operations or to minimize ALH operations from ship deck because of corrosion. We have a video which I'll share with you after the presentation, after the session. As regards your first question, can you just go over the last part of the first question again?
Knowing the ship motion.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
Is going to help.
Yes. Finally, when you land, you would want to land at the most quiescent period, at the most calm period. The sea motion as well as the ship motion has got alternate peaks and troughs, and in between these peaks and troughs there are quiescent periods where the deck is relatively stable. So we would like to land at that time. Now what is happening is most of the aids only give instantaneous ship motion. Now that is of no use to the pilot. What the pilot would like to see is when is the motion the least. So there are systems which are in vogue right now which takes the ship's motion and computes a quiescent period or a landing period and shows a green light or a signal to the helicopter pilot when he is hovering so that he can put down the helicopter instantly. So yes, I would like to know what is the quiescent period rather than what is the absolute value of roll and pitch.
Okay, thank you, Commander Kumar. Just please stand there. All of you will agree that it was a very fascinating talk, and at the end of it I have a confession to make to this audience that I am very happy that I am not a naval helicopter pilot. Ha ha ha.